very rare conversation with the otherwise rather elusive Omar Apollo.
Elusive?
When it comes to going on the record, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we've done a few of these kind of conversations and interviews before, but they've never gone anywhere near to the conversations we've had when all of this isn't around.
Mm-hmm.
And I respect that, you know. I never expect artists to show up with cameras and microphones to present their natural self. But here we are. We got to make the most of it because this album deserves it, man.
Thank you, man. No, I love this album. It's great. It took me forever. A lot of blood, sweat, and tears. A lot of sleepless nights.
You know, a fairly significant false start as well, according to conversations we've had, that you sort of were going down one road and then it was like, this is the road.
Yeah.
What was going on with the music that made you want to change tact and kind of write more and come up with something else?
I was kind of new in LA at the time and I didn't know anybody, but, you know, the label was like, oh, we could put you in with whoever you want. And I was like, okay, cool. Like, I'm down. I did that for like a few months and just worked with so many people, like 25 producers probably.
Everybody up in the hills in their home studios.
Everybody but myself. I was so used to making music by myself. So it was, you know, I had this, you know, I wasn't good at setting boundaries at the time.
What does that mean? I love that you pointed that out, but I'd love to know in more detail. What do you mean by boundaries?
So boundaries for me is probably like no key to everything, key to the making the music, key to like, you know, the process and all that stuff. Because I would send the people that I work with who like, you know, think of my music in like a marketing or like a business way, everything.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of, you know, can be extremely draining and stressful, you know, dealing with like so many people's opinions. And like, you know, they're saying, oh, this should be this, or this should be that. All of a sudden, I have this album done that I just hate. And I'm like, oh, man.
Based in part on feedback from others, you're basically creating an album that is sort of a composite of other people's opinions before you've even had a chance to define your own opinion.
Exactly. And that's tough to admit. Like, it's like, damn, like, I really just let that happen. Because I'm the type of person where, you know, now it's very different. I'm very, you know, I understand, like, the leadership role when it comes to, you know, making decisions and, you know, listening to other people. But at that time, I just wanted to make everyone who was with me happy because I honestly didn't get, like, why the label thought I was cool or like why they all like I'm like I have to prove myself like I have to when I already did like they signed me like I'm good like
well, you're not alone there's a psychology that's permeated through the arts for the mm-hmm. longest time
until I just decided you know to just set a boundary and then yeah and then so I said this isn't coming out, we're about to roll out the album. Like, this isn't coming out. This song isn't coming out.
How close to the release of that? I mean, how far
down
the road?
2 days before the first video shoot. It was a big budget. It was a fat budget.
It was epic.
It was my biggest budget at the time. I was like,
I know for me, I've been trusting my process long enough now to know when my instinct's screaming at me versus it's just kind of whispering at me.
Exactly. And that's something I had to realize because I was just compromising and, you know, it started not being my vision. I had to kind of be the bad guy and it's like, I didn't like that pressure. I'm not a very confrontational person. Mm-hmm. Now I am, but before, like naturally, I'm just not.
The good news is this new album is nothing but just, man, every piece of like creative opportunity you could have dragged that inspired you, you pulled into this record, man, and it's you in a nutshell right now. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
It's like four Omar Apollos all having dinner together on this album.
That's amazing. I love that.
And I wonder what it's like for you at this point, having covered a fair amount of ground, put out quite a lot of music, how you feel like you've improved singing what I would consider to be more heritage-based music. Is there a part of making those songs that you feel that is, and I mean this as a good thing,
mm-hmm.
is an obligation based on where you've come from and who your family is and what music means to them versus the Omar you've become as an individual?
You know, when I first started doing shows, you know, like Texas and stuff like that, it was literally only like Latina girls, literally. Like that was the vibe. So it just felt like home and everyone was like, it's so good to see, you know, Mexican kids singing, and you know, that was, it made me feel like, oh wow, this is bigger than what I thought it was, you know, that, you know, just, you know, my parents being from Mexico and, you know, me being first generation Mexican in America, that meant a lot because it was kind of just reality for me growing up. But yeah, it's very, you know, it's definitely a thought that goes through my head every time I'm, you know, making music.
Is there a time when you would commit to that wholeheartedly on a project, you know, rather than it being
I was thinking about that.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, obviously my life is bilingual, you know, I speak English and Spanish. It's not fully Spanish, but I definitely do want to, you know, make a full Spanish album. I think that would be so sick.
It'd be incredible.
I have enough music for a Spanish album, but I want to make it more intentional as opposed to just, you know, these are like Spanish songs that I just put together.
So I guess the question is, like, when you started this album again, because the first one, that was controversial. 2 days before a video shoot, that's controversy. That's controversy.
That was bad.
That's controversy.
I don't ever want to do that again, but, you know, it happens, man. Like, happens. Honestly, if I felt like I didn't try my best, then I wouldn't be proud of, you know, the album.
Well, you had to at that point.
Yeah,
it's like anything but your best would mean that nothing's going to come out on that label, right? Because okay, you get to do that once.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get back and you start working on Ivory in earnest, like, let's get into this. What was the kind of, apart from Invincible, which you had moving, maybe that was the starting point, how did you know, like, all right, this is the roadmap I have to be on? I cannot be all over the road like I was in the last one.
That video shoot was going to be the start of the rollout, and it was, everything was mixed and everything, and I just found myself compromising so much. I wasn't excited about it releasing. I wasn't, you know, hype about performing them or learning them. And also, I had a really, really good friend of mine tell me, like, you need to actually confront these feelings and say something about it, as opposed to just, you know, going with the flow how you've been doing your whole life, you know, and that really changed everything for me. So.
Yeah.
That kind of was like, okay, I'm going to make a new album in 3 months, go to Idlewild and different places, like every week, spend 2 weeks there and make all new songs. And then that's what I did.
Let's talk about the theme, Ivory. It's a powerful word. What does it mean, and why did you call the album Ivory?
I honestly love words that end in vowels.
Mm-hmm.
But I just loved how it looked, one. So that's already like good for me. But I made a song called Ivory, and it's about having a trust with somebody that you would never break, no matter what.
Let's talk about the song with Daniel, which has been out for a minute and is one of my favorite songs, a lot of people's favorite songs of the year. Really unique, sort of almost semi-traditional bluesy type riff with but modern production. And it's like very interesting song.
So the song started like, you know, kind of rock feeling, like more of folk rock kind of that world, like Neil Young kind of thing. And then Daniel came in with like a reggae pocket, so it was just sick.
And I love how, I've said this to you before off the record, I love how you're the first song on your long-awaited second album proper starts with someone else.
Yeah. It was just, that was just how it happened. That was the order of which things kind of happened. So I was like, oh, I like how it sounds. It sounds good to me.
What did you learn from working with Pharrell? I ask that to everyone who works with Pharrell.
Oh, man.
The working with Pharrell is just an extended playbook of life.
That was the craziest trip of my life. I remember the first night I didn't even sleep. Like, I didn't sleep the night after because he loved what I made. And we were just talking about it. He brought up everyone from upstairs. Like Pusha T was there, and like he brought up everybody. Like, I was like, y'all gotta hear this. He played it, pressed space bar, and I'm like, yo, I didn't know you were gonna like it. Like,
that's awesome.
And I was just geeked. I was just so excited. And Pharrell just got the best taste, man. He trusts himself. That's what's crazy. He really trusts himself. He just does, you know, does his thing, and then it's that. That's the song. And I'm like, okay, bet. Like, he's like, it's good. I'm like, yeah, it's good. Like, let me start writing. And yeah, like that was. And also, like, you know, when it comes to structure, that's something I really notice is he really, really, like, knows, obviously. But to hear him talk about it was just amazing.
I do have a question for you that relates to this, though. You know, it seems to me that when you started, this was never the plan. And there really probably wasn't even a plan.
Yeah, there wasn't.
How does that make you feel looking back? And I know you don't look back very often, but moments like this, I guess you maybe allow yourself a chance to reflect. Like, this has been a journey that's kind of unveiled itself to you, right?
You know when they say, like, when you don't care about something, it comes to you. Then you start caring about it, and then you're like, well, what the heck? Now I'm at the part where I'm caring about it, and I'm like, how did I do this before? Like, you know, I just gotta think back and just be like, oh, let me just be me exactly, and, you know, work hard, and, you know, actually apply myself and try my best, and that's all I can do. So
yeah,
just try my best and try to be prepared.